folks, I'll get started here in just a minute. But keep me honest on time. If I don't sit up here and ramble for too long, I want to show you some of this in action. I just wrapped up applying this the material from this talk to a certain movie studio that released a flick this last weekend that has me furious. Maybe go out and see Batman versus Superman. Thoughts? I haven't seen it yet. I have deliberately avoided going to see it because, and I saw you, got the invite. Number one, I'm a Marvel guy, so I'm already committed to one house. But anyway, I'll save that for the end. Well, if we're good, I'll go ahead and get started. We'll see about what time we wrap up. And then, like I said, I'll jump over to my other laptop and bring up all the work I already did. For folks who don't know me, this is me. I have two certifications to my name. Yay, certs. I tested for my CISSP forever ago. I found out it does really well when you put it on a resume to get you somewhere. Good foundational knowledge. The GWAPT I just picked up recently, that's the SANS web app pen testing. I made a move to the higher ed space about a year ago. I'm with Ohio State University now. Turns out that educational institutions like to train their people. So I got to do some web app stuff. I'm getting to do a little more here in a few, but I dig it. I'm an advocate of trying to break things in a legal, safe fashion. I strongly believe that if you want to effectively secure the systems, applications, mobile devices, whatever you're responsible for, if you understand how to break them, then you have an understanding of how the criminals who might want to do harm or the employees who might want to take advantage of unmanaged access on the inside, you get an understanding of what they might do, and then you can put realistic, effective controls in place. What I want to talk about today, OSINT, I want to give you an understanding of something that that we don't traditionally scan for, right, that may or may not be in your security program, but I guarantee is in somebody's pen testing program, whether you've authorized them to pen test you or not. So hopefully you'll walk away with information. If you're online right now, highly encourage you to do this against your own organizations. We're not going to be breaking any rules. You won't get into trouble, and it's eye-opening. First question, how many of you have ever Googled yourself? So we're all friends here. It's okay. That's a big number. Wow, that's a lot. I did it a little bit ago. I wanted to see what showed up when you Google me. I'm on a Russian website, which sometimes concerns me, but I wrote a blog a while back and somebody picked it up and translated it, so thank you, Internet. Googling yourself is the same process that we're going through. It's looking at publicly available information to determine what people can find out about you online. So if you want to secure an organization, step number one, hack yourself. What I want to cover today, four basic questions. Number one, what the heck is OSINT? What's your process? I'm a big fan of documenting repeatable procedures so that we can do this again and again over time. What OSINT tools should I know about? We do get to geek out a little bit today. And then how do I defend myself? After you're sufficiently frightened, I'll show you some of the good news. So let's start at the beginning. What is OSINT? Open source intelligence. Military, you get SIGINT, HUMINT. If we're going to target an organization, if you're a criminal or a criminal enterprise and you want to compromise a hotel network through ransomware, if you want to gain access to people's direct deposit accounts so that you can change the destination of their paychecks to an account that you control, if you don't like a particular company and you want to take their website offline so that they can't present themselves to the outside world, these are all attacks that take some sort of preparation. You have to know who the employees are that you're attacking. You have to know what the website is that you're targeting. What technologies does it run? Who are the employees who are getting paid by the organization that you want to compromise their paychecks? gathering that information can come in one of two ways. And I'm another big fan of the pen test execution standard, right? A repeatable process for executing penetration tests. Within the pen test execution standard, after you've documented your pre-engagement, what do I say, rules of engagement, right? If you're going to run a pen test, what am I allowed to do? What am I not allowed to do? The very next thing you're going to do is gather intelligence about the target organization. The two ways you can gather intelligence are through active intelligence gathering, which is going to be loud and noisy and show up in logs everywhere. An Nmap scan, for example, is active intelligence gathering. Show me what ports are listening on internet-facing servers. But passive intelligence gathering is a lot more frightening. Passive intelligence gathering is where I want to talk about OSINT. And in some cases, you're going to use information that doesn't reside anywhere on the corporate infrastructure. And in other cases, you can use tools that, while they might actively gather information about a target, it's going to come from an IP address that isn't yours, which, again, gives you an advantage over time of staying in the shadows until you're ready to strike. So as I mentioned, I'm a big fan of processes. If you are going to stay on top of what your organization looks like from an OSINT perspective, you can't do it just once and then walk away. You need to come back again and again. Some of the tools I'm going to show you haven't updated their information in years. So you might find information that's 2 or 3 years old. And other tools are updating their information on a daily, if not hourly, basis. So gathering that information over time is going to require a process where somebody goes in, compares results to what they saw last time, and then course correct. The first step that that I follow when I'm executing a penetration test, or if I'm just curious, is I profile the target organization. I profile the company. If the company's publicly traded, you can pop out to EDGAR on the SEC website and pull down documents about filings. This is not going to give you any technical information, but it's going to tell you, number one, how do they make money? Very important to know. Number two, who are some of the people involved at the leadership level in the process? And then once you start to paint a picture of the company, you can complement that with information you find on Google Finance. There are multiple sites. Hoover's is another that if you're paying for a subscription, you might get some good data there. Google Finance, free. But you're going to be limited to people who are publicly traded. If I'm looking at a smaller organization, a private company, higher education institution, go out to LinkedIn. LinkedIn has become an increasingly valuable treasure trove of information from attackers. If somebody is actively managing an organization's LinkedIn page, they're going out of their way to share information about what services does the company offer, what products do they offer, finding people who work at the organization, and what technologies the IT administrators have listed in their LinkedIn resume. It's going to give you a terrific picture of what this company looks like from an insider's perspective. Profiling the company can also involve scouring the company website. I've seen company websites that have the entire company directory listed on one page. Contact information for everybody in the company, which fish me much. But social engineering is going to come into play when you're ready to take all the information you've gathered and execute an attack. And you're going to find a tremendous amount of social data about the person or about the company on LinkedIn, and then combined with the company website. The one caveat here is when you're looking at EDGAR, Google Finance, LinkedIn, you're not showing up in any logs on the company side. As soon as you hit their website, then your IP address, your source IP, is going to show up in their logs. So is anybody familiar with Tails? Maybe heard the name. It's a you've got Tails, you've got Tor, but a virtual machine that you can run it as a VM, or you can boot it directly from like a flash drive or a DVD. But it lets you browse the internet anonymously. And if you're going through Tor or using Tor exit nodes, then you're able to at least disguise your IP. But step one, profile the company. And then once you have an understanding of who they are, who works there, how do they make money, then you can move on to profiling the people. So stay on LinkedIn for a bit. Start visiting individual profiles. I'm not condoning this action, but I'm telling you that it is possible. If you were to create a LinkedIn account that doesn't represent an actual person, once you have a profile on LinkedIn, you have a lot more information than just trying to search LinkedIn through Google or DuckDuckGo with an unauthenticated account without access to the application. If you have a LinkedIn account and if you've spent time building out your own professional network, you can start visiting everybody's page. Just be aware that you're going to show up as this person viewed your profile. So you want to adjust your privacy settings. Think maybe even shell out. LinkedIn lets you pay for some of their more advanced functions or services, but you can be extremely secretive if you configure your profile to say, don't let people see that I was the one who searched for them. Anonymize my search. Get on Facebook. Yes, you're going to find out what they eat for lunch. You're going to find out what their kids were doing. And I say that as a father of three. My kids' antics end up on Facebook more than I'd like to admit. But this gives you the insight into the person as, or the people who work at the company as individuals. What are their interests? What are their hobbies? I have spent a portion of my career in consulting. And while I was consulting, I conducted more than my fair share of penetration tests. There was one organization we were targeting out of state that had a password reset portal that I knew for certain I could get in as anybody if I could just answer the two secret questions that they'd posted on this portal. Now, the company had implemented the portal well so that it actually prompted you when you created your password reset profile for 10 separate secret questions. So you had to answer 10 secret questions, and then when you tried to use the application, it would pull two of those questions at random and say, answer these two. And if you got one of the answers wrong, it would say, okay, that's strike one. You get one more shot. And after strike two, we're cutting your access off, and you have to call the help desk to get reset. So it was really well thought out in terms of a brute force attack. I couldn't just sit there and hammer away all day. But my gosh, if I want to know what somebody's middle name is, if I want to know their birthday, what street they grew up on, what their pet's name was, parents' maiden names, right, mother's maiden name, if I can get on Facebook and connect to somebody who's connected, or if somebody doesn't have their profile appropriately locked down, I can often gather that information in an innocuous fashion. If I wanted to be more deliberate, I would create one of those stupid little quizzes that says, hey, what's your middle name? Hey, what's your dog's name? And then let people answer that information and submit that. That, again, crosses the line. But at the very least, just poke around on Facebook. Twitter, the difference I see when I'm profiling people on Facebook versus Twitter, Twitter is much more conversational. That's the nature of the technology. They want people to engage in short, hopefully witty conversations, right? Give me 140 characters and let me make somebody laugh. But what you develop, the information you gather when you're looking at their Twitter account is, who do they talk to? What do they talk about? I won't go into specifics, but look at people in our own industry and look at what they say about the people they're working for, the people they're working with, the companies they're working for. Another resource that isn't really, it's not as easy to tap into because of the anonymization inherent to the platform, but Reddit. Go out to the sysadmin subreddit on Reddit, and people will divulge a ridiculous amount of information about their organization with the hopes that you can't map their Reddit username back to their real name. In addition to social media and some of the platforms where people might go to share information or vent frustrations, hit up search engines. Google and Bing, good resources. DuckDuckGo, if you're more privacy-friendly, DuckDuckGo makes their stance. They don't track anything about you, so if you're concerned about that, it's going to give you a lot of the same information. Here's a little pro tip for you. for your own website, use the site modifier. So in the search engine bar, type the word site, colon, and then your domain name, not the www. Just do the, like if we got Abercrombie, I've seen some Abercrombie guys here. I spent some time in ANF, Abercrombie.com, or for those guys, because I can't see if you're in the room or not, the company portal. Plug in that domain. What I like to do is I start with that. Just show me every URL that the search engine knows about, and then I add one more word to narrow my results. How many of those web pages have the word login? How many of those web pages have the word password or reset? And you can find, so in case I don't bring it up, I want to make sure to share with you. I was looking at Warner Brothers pictures today for the Batman versus Superman, and I thought I'd try that out. So WarnerBros.com is their company website, and it's a marketing site. It's just there to tell you about what movies they have coming out and then different entertainment properties. But go out there and type in site:WarnerBros.com and log in, and one of the top hits tells you what vendor they've chosen for their two-factor authentication solution. Oh, that's nice. See, now I'm starting to technically profile an organization. I'm getting an understanding of what technologies they have. And keep in mind, I haven't touched their infrastructure yet. After you've profiled the companies and the people, this one's a gimme, but look and see if anybody else has already compromised them. Where have they demonstrated a weakness? Some organizations, if you have a breach, then there's always the knee-jerk reaction. I have to hire a security company. They come in, tell me how it happened, do forensics, tell me what I should change. I'll add that to my 5-year strategic plan and eventually fix all the holes that they called out. If the organization handles healthcare data, OCR? Yeah. Their wall of shame, anybody who's had a breach of 500 or more records, it's all publicly exposed out there. So if you search for HIPAA wall of shame, you'll get that as the top hit. Privacyrights.org, hands down my favorite. Every publicly disclosed data breach since 2005, in a searchable database that you can filter by industry, by how the hack happened. If it was a hack of a particular technology, if it was an insider job, if it was a lost or stolen device, or just somebody sent an email that they shouldn't have. And then you can that industry and then year. So you can really narrow it down to say, what types of breaches am I seeing in this particular industry? So retail, what problems does retail have versus higher ed versus finance? Do I see patterns or trends? Or let's just look over the past 3 months. What breaches are we seeing? Because if somebody has found a way in at 2 or 3 companies, then maybe, just maybe, you'll have some luck with getting into another company. Even if the company you're profiling doesn't show up in the list, there's still value there. And then the other, the way I like to think of these sites, privacy rights is for people who know they've been breached. Pastebin is for the ones who don't know it yet. If someone has been compromised, I think it was Dropbox, they had an issue some years ago where somebody said, hey, I got into Dropbox infrastructure and swiped all these passwords. Now, depending on how they've chosen to implement password technology in their web apps, if they've done it right, they only have hashed values that have been hashed with a salt, so there's no way to get back to the passwords, and it's a load of BS. But if they're storing those passwords plain text because they want to be able to respond to password requests for users, password reset requests, then they may be storing that information insecurely internally. If somebody compromises an organization, and they want to monetize that, if they want to make a little bit of change back on what they did, they might go out to Pastebin and say, hey, I just compromised 100,000 user credentials for your company. Here's a list of 1,000. So I want to prove I have the goods. Go through these, and if you think that I'm legit, then send so many Bitcoin to this address, and I'll give you the entire list. What you do with it at that point is up to you. Whether or not that information is accurate or correct, is a conversation for another talk. At the very least, if somebody has got into your infrastructure through an insecure web application, if they've compromised user accounts that belong to your users, Searching for your company domain name or your email domain name is a great way to pull that information back. So look for previous breaches. And then the last step that I recommend you take is profiling the internet-facing infrastructure. When I say that, I break mobile and web out into two separate categories. What I have found in the mobile space is that there are a number of organizations who have been quick to publish mobile applications to iTunes and Google Play without understanding the security steps they should have taken in developing those applications before putting that data in a public resource or a public app store. If, for example, the developers don't understand code signing, code obfuscation, controls to ensure that somebody can't get back to the original source code, the very nature of a mobile application requires that you take the source code, compile it, and then publish it to the app store that people so that people can download it and have a copy on their device. Well, with Android files in particular, you can go to sites like apkpure.com, apkpure.com. You don't even have to go to Google Play, folks. You can just say, here's the Google Play URL of the APK I want, and then they'll actually pull that APK file down and let you download it to your local machine. At that point, if the developers haven't properly secured the code against a reverse engineering style attack, it takes all of 5 minutes to get back to the original Java source code within that mobile app. Within that Java source code, if you have any API keys, API secret keys, that you think are secret because they're hidden in the APK file and somebody can't get to it, it's security through obscurity, and it is incredibly ineffective. At the very least, and this is something I want everybody to know before you take a look at your own mobile apps, a mobile app file, like an Android app file, is just a zip file, folks. If you download that APK file from the Google Play Store and rename it to .zip, you can open it with whatever zip utility you have installed. If you're on a company machine that doesn't allow you to install any software, you can still rename it to .zip, and a Windows laptop, Windows will flip that to the default compression format, double-click on it, and you can start to see both binary and plain text files. Config files that contain those API keys, if they're left in that that APK file, or same with iTunes in the IPA file, then you can start profiling how an organization enables mobile users to connect back to their web infrastructure through that mobile application without any security tools at all. A zip utility and a notepad tool. Even opening up binary files in a tool like Notepad++, my favorite. You can do searches for like HTTP, HTTPS, and you get a feel for what web services have been exposed for the mobile apps to talk to. All of these are attack points, but it's the web infrastructure where you're going to get some really sexy targets, and I didn't want to go into detail here because I'm going to give you a ton of tools that you can focus on there. So, profiled the organization, we know what OSN is. Step three, let's start talking about tools. Automation, folks. That's where it's at. Automate all the things. So, with web applications and the web infrastructure, the servers that are hosting the apps, four tools that I recommend you bookmark, the Netcraft site report. If you go out to the Netcraft site report and plug in a website name, it tells you what technologies are used within that web application. If somebody discovers a Drupal zero day and publishes information about that zero day to a forum that attackers can start taking advantage of, the Netcraft site report will tell you whether or not the site you're targeting has Drupal. It's going to tell you about the web server. Are they running IIS or Apache? Which version? There was a version of jQuery that had a cross-site scripting bug in the library. And if you've done any web app dev, you know that jQuery is freaking everywhere. So is there now a possibility for me to socially engineer users build out a cross-site scripting attack on their website because Netcraft told me they have jQuery within the app? So that's a good start. One of the Whois links, ICANN or Aaron, What I like about these is this is where you get into high-profile targets for social engineering. The people whose contact information is going to end up on Aaron, for example, are the network admins with the keys to the kingdom. If an organization has registered their network blocks using a generic network at company.com or helpdesk at company.com, then you're kind of stuck. But if you've got an individual's name and that individual's email address, now you know who you want to target if you're going after network config files or if you want access to internal systems. How about the Hurricane Electric looking glass, the BGP toolkit? Somebody toyed around out here. You start with an AS number for the website. You start with a domain name or an IP address, but ultimately you're going for that AS number. And then you plug in the AS number, and the website will guide you to a list of every DNS entry it knows about tied to individual IP addresses. So now, instead of having to run a port scanner and maybe a web application security scanner to try to identify IP addresses and host names, you just go out and query the BGP looking glass, and it's going to tell you everything it knows about. So this gives you a picture of what systems do they have on the internet, what are the DNS entries, IP addresses, what technologies do they use on some of the web pages, starting to paint that picture. A couple of others, when I dig deeper into the web application that I like coming back to, Qualys SSL Labs. I love this tool. I do a lot of third-party risk assessments in my current role, so when somebody wants to do business with the university, they come through our group and we say, are you doing security on par with what we expect? And they say, well, yes, I am. And so the first thing I do is I plug in their web application landing page into the Qualys SSL Labs tool and look for vulnerabilities like Drown or Poodle or Heartbleed, right? And I have folks in my role, I have found people that tell me we patch quarterly, like clockwork. We go in every quarter, every system that has critical vulnerability, we just patch it outright, no questions asked. A year later, they've still got Poodle on the application they're asking our users to use. And I ask, well, what about this? What's going on here? Oh, we must have missed that one. So it has multiple uses, but Qualys SSL Labs is going to help you understand whether or not their web application encryption is up to snuff, or if you've got any vulnerabilities you might be able to exploit. Punk Spider from Hyperion Gray, another great tool. If anybody's run a web app scanner like Zap or OWASP or AppScan, you've been through the process of analyzing every input in a web application and looking for a vulnerability you might be able to exploit. Punk Spider is like a searchable database of web app scans that somebody else already ran. So plug in your domain name out here. Now, when you go out to the Punk Spider website, there are going to be a list of options along the bottom, like XSS, right, cross-site scripting, SQLi, BSQL, SQL injection, blind SQL injection. You want to click all of the options and then click the OR button. And what that's saying is look for my domain and then any of these vulnerabilities. If you click the AND button, you're never going to get anything unless you have an absolutely horrible website. But Punk Spider might give you results that are 2 years old, 3 years old. But if you find that there was an issue 2 or 3 years ago with SQL injection vulnerabilities or cross-site scripting vulnerabilities on a particular domain, have they fixed it yet? Do they know about it? Are they still releasing code that has those vulnerabilities? Ultra Tools is one of multiple vendors that has this DNS zone transfer. In a perfect world, nobody would allow DNS zone transfers from unauthenticated internet-facing systems. If I call to your DNS server and say, I want you to give me a copy of your IP address and DNS mapping table, show me all the systems that you know about, not only on the outside, but then in the DMZ and on the inside. That stuff has no business outside of your organization. But if the server administrator doesn't understand I need to turn that off, or if they've turned it on at some point to support some troubleshooting effort and then just forgot to turn it off after the fact, then an attacker can grab that information and have not just your perimeter systems, but now have visibility to some of the systems on the internal network. Once I'm in, what are some of the IP addresses of high-profile targets I'm going to want to jump right to? You can do a zone transfer with DIG or NSLOOKUP from your local machine, but if you go to a website that offers a service like AlterTools, your IP doesn't show up in the logs. It's theirs. And then my absolute favorite, Shodan. How many folks have used Shodan? Yes. After today, I want everybody to use it. Please, at least once. Shodan is a search engine of things. So it's going to show you all the IP addresses it knows about on a for a particular organization. The documentation, it's a little light. I actually have a paid Shodan account because I use it so much. I found a lot of value in going a little deeper than what the free account gives you. But in Shodan, there's one parameter called org. So do you remember earlier I said go out to DuckDuckGo and use site, colon, and then the domain name? In Shodan, use org, O-R-G, colon, and then in parentheses, the name of your organization. It may take a little bit of tweaking to find out what name the search engine knows about, like how it identifies systems with your, associated with your company. But once you have that org parameter right, you're going to get back a ridiculous amount of information about systems, so DNS entries, IP addresses, and specific ports that they're listening on, including banner grabs. So Warner Brothers, for example. I found the org value for Warner Brothers and brought that up. And when I did a search, and this was maybe, what, half an hour ago, 45 minutes ago, the top hit was an FTP server in the UK. No, not an SFTP server, folks. FTP, port 21. So unencrypted traffic with login and password passing in plain text. Now, with Warner Brothers, like, not to pick on them as a specific company, but just as an industry in general, I'm a big movie geek. I mean, I'm ridiculously passionate about stories and how stories appear on screen. I have been sorely tempted to get my hands on some of the screeners that I've got friends who work in the industry who get the movies on Blu-ray before or DVD before anybody else gets them so they can screen and chime in on their opinions. And I really dig the idea of being able to catch all these flicks now instead of waiting, you know, weeks or months to get them. I don't act on it, but I, again, sorely tempted. Warner Brothers, their intellectual property, especially in the movie production side, is their movies. They don't want Batman versus Superman leaking before the premiere night because how's that going to impact ticket sales? Not too bad. They made a ridiculous amount of money, but it's still going to take some change out of their pocket that they could be making. So they want to protect that information. If I can get into their system through an unencrypted FTP server, whether it's through social engineering, the credentials of somebody who uses that server, whether it's packet capture, if I'm just coincidentally on the same network as somebody who logs in. But again, social engineering the creds would be the way to go. Or brute force, right? There's got to be some way I can get that information. Then maybe I can get to a back-end system or an internal system where they have some of these files that I so desperately want. When talking about shifting from passive to active, if your open source intelligence gathering involves you digging deeper through search engine engine analysis, Google hacking, Google dorking, if you want to look into some of the specific parameters, Google, DuckDuckGo, Bing, as I mentioned, ridiculously powerful for profiling an organization. If you want to find all of the spreadsheets that somebody has publicly accessible from their corporate domain, site, colon, company name, file type, colon, XLS. File type, colon, XLSX. Google, I just want you to show me every spreadsheet you know about on this website. PDFs, MPPs. What's an MPP? Somebody's got to know this one. Microsoft Project Plan. I have worked with organizations who have, we have found Microsoft Project Plans on an internet-facing website. Didn't mean to. Ended up there anyway. Google's going to find it before you do. Has anybody used FOCA? I love this one. This is another one of my favorites. FOCA analyzes the metadata of the documents. So you point FOCA at a domain and say, I want you to, number one, find every document you can. PDF, PowerPoint, spreadsheet. If it's a file, download it. And then step two, I want you to go through the metadata. Show me what you know about file shares and print shares and credentials. Show me the technology that was used to create this file. Show me the name of the workstation where this file was created. Show me the name of the person who, anybody who uses Microsoft Word, right? The first time we log in, what's it prompt us for? What's your name and what's your initials? Well, all that information stays in these documents that get published online. FOCA will pull that information out and just make it click, like menu-driven, that you can sort through and start understanding who's creating files, who are people on the inside of the company, what's the username convention, what's the workstation naming convention. So an important quote, very popular, automation folks, that's where it's at. You want repeatable processes, and you want to put tools in place that are going to help you move quickly. Two tools that you can use to accelerate the process, Multigo, has grown up pretty popular in this space from Patera. You can either tap into their servers, or you can stand up your own servers on the inside. They have what's called transforms, that a lot of the stuff I've talked about going to websites and doing manually, you can do that and more with a single click once you define your target profile. They give you a warning when you use the tool, though. If you're not careful, if you don't understand the process, like what the tool does in the background, you could actually create a denial of service condition against some of your internet-facing technologies. So buyer beware, right? Go out there and be careful with using that. ReconNG, though, is pretty sexy. I like this one a lot. Tim Tomes, project team put this together, and he talked about it at DerbyCon, it's been like 3-4 years? DerbyCon and some other con. But he showed in a presentation with this tool that it feels very much like Metasploit, right, running it from a Linux command line in like Kali or Backtrack. But he was able to get credentials for a federal agency. So username, password, without ever touching a federal system. And it was looking at all of these resources and the number of modules that they have in the ReconNG toolkit now is just ridiculous. You won't use them all, but it's built in such a way that as deep as you want to go, they've got something there to automate that process of going out to the internet, gathering that information, pulling it down, and then it lets you collate all of the recon activity into a single report. So you could go through the manual process if you want to take time, and I highly recommend that, right? Just learn what sources and what sites you can tap into and how this stuff works. And then when you're ready to build it into your internal processes, right, start running recurring scans or doing that analysis to determine what you look like today versus a month ago, these two tools should absolutely be in the toolkit. Multigo, they have a free version that's incredibly lightweight. Like you only get, a dozen hosts? It's tiny. But it's not expensive if you wanted to pay. I mean, especially that corporate budget, it's a pittance. But ReconNG is free. You can build that into like a Kali distro or a Backtrack distro. So how do you defend yourself? Jared's been sitting up here rambling about all these terrible things that you can't defend yourself from. It's important that we reflect on, just for a moment, everything I've just covered. How much of what I just talked about would show up in your IDS, IPS logs, firewall logs? Anything? Maybe some of the website analysis, but again, if they're using Tor or they're using it within Tails, you're not going to be able to track it back to even knowing what part of the world the attacker is coming from. So without that ability to build logging and monitoring in place, you have to build more of a proactive approach to tackling this. So number one, if you are using Shodan to find open ports that aren't authorized, right? Shodan says that you've got this server at this branch office that for some unknown reason is listening on port 3389. right? If you see that in Shodan, then all you have to do is go to the server and turn it off, or at least talk to the business user, sysadmin, and say, why aren't we doing this through VPN? Why are we exposing remote desktop over the internet? If you find web app vulnerabilities on Punk Spider, go talk to your devs, right? Hey, folks, this showed up. Why is this out here? Zone transfers, hopefully you don't find any of those, but if you do, just turn them off. That's a simple query, depending on what DNS server you're running. How do I turn off zone transfers? If you find passwords on Pastebin, treat that as a minor security incident. I say minor. I don't think it justifies public notification. But if you've got internal passwords on Pastebin, even if they've been changed at some point, have the user go in and change their password again just to make sure that they're not currently compromised. And then if you're finding information about users on social media, if you are able to map somebody back to their Reddit username or password, or you see somebody on their Facebook page thinking about the technology you're getting ready to deploy and this big work thing coming up, that's a training issue, folks. You can address all of this stuff. Everything that shows up in OSINT, right, in all of these analyses, you can address them after you go through this process yourself and just see what's out there. Everything you need to fix is simple. You don't need a big box. It's not going to be a ridiculous, expensive project. It's a lot of information security 101 stuff. So if you want to dig deeper into this, onstrat.com, Online Strategies, has an OSINT section that's beyond ridiculous. There's more out there than you'll ever want to use. So it's I've not found a more in-depth resource online. And some of the stuff that I've built into my own processes, it's just like scratching the surface of what they have out there. Go out to the Pentest Execution Standard. Get an understanding of, it's in the technical guidelines, that it talks about some different tools, like Creepy, the little Python script for tracking people and location. There are a few other tools I didn't touch on just because I don't use them that often, but given your specific use case, you might find value in them. And then I have a couple of websites I maintain. Anytime I have information to share that I think people are going to want to come back to, I put it somewhere so that it's searchable. Out on itsecuritycareer.com, I've got a blog entry called What You Don't Know About OSINT Can Hurt You. A lot of the information I covered here today is in that presentation or in that blog entry. So I know I've got all the stuff from Warner Brothers up on my laptop, but my phone's telling me that I did ramble just long enough that I can't show you that. So if you wanted to have some fun, I'll just tell you this. If you poke around at the Warner Brothers domain, warnerbros.com, you might find some interesting connections between what I talked about today and how this stuff is actually applied. Before we wrap up, though, any questions? Anything you want to know about what I cover? Yeah, Rob. That's a great question. So Rob's question, when I'm profiling a mobile app, if I run into code protection, do I stop there? Given the tools that I have and my personal depth of knowledge on mobile, if I try to reverse a Google app and somebody's put a snippet of C code in the middle of their Java code because they wanted to hide a function from people like me, then that does trip me up. I get stuck and I don't have a way to go back and get to the C code. But I still continue to profile the app through that WinZip Notepad++. I go through every single file in the Notepad editor and I look for certain strings and patterns that are likely to show me where, even in the compiled code, if for some reason the thing I'm looking for compiled in plain text and I can pull that out, then I've got something I can use. So it slows me down, but I still look because there's always something tasty in there. Good question. Any other questions? Yeah. Any reliable way to know if I've stumbled upon a honeypot? In my pen testing days, the honeypots are traditionally too good to be true. If you've got somebody who's standing up a honeypot and their goal is to catch everybody, then they're going to turn on port 21, 22, 80, 443, 3389. And when I see like ports 22 and 3389, to me that's a red flag, because 22 is SSH traditionally on Linux systems, occasionally on Microsoft. 3389 is remote desktop protocol, only on Microsoft. I've never seen 3389 on a Linux box. And when I find a system that has so many different ways for me to connect to it, that I've got my pick of attack vector, I'm more inclined to think it's a honeypot and pull back. But depending when you're doing like Shodan searches, you'll find that on the outside. One of the challenges you have after you apply this, once you get on the inside, if they've got honeypots on the internal network, you don't have the opportunity to find that info out without actually touching it. And as soon as you touch it, they know. So that's it's the too good to be true approach is what I followed. But I'm not always right. Good question, though. Any other questions? Well, folks, I very much appreciate your time today. Again, I highly recommend do all this. Even if you don't feel comfortable knowing the technical security stuff, you can't break anything with any of the websites I showed you, and nobody's going to catch you because it won't show up in the logs anywhere. If you have any questions after the fact or something you didn't want to ask here in front of everybody, LinkedIn is the best way to hit me up, S-L-A-N-D-A-I-L. Twitter is the second best. I usually see LinkedIn stuff right away. Twitter, I don't always get to hang out there. Appreciate your time. I hope you're able to stick around for the next presenter, and I'll see you around. Thank you.